Election 2022 underway. 6 weeks for Australia to decide. Queensland key to the result.
Our government is not perfect. We've never claimed to be. But we are up front.
I won't go missing when the going gets tough.
A surprise twist in the mandatory vaccination debate, with the Human Rights Commission siding with teachers. The former Trump advisor who will lead Queensland's 2032 Olympic Committee. But why has it taken 263 days just to form one? 20 years after a Queensland crime that shocked two nations, tonight Carolyn Stuttle's legacy is revealed. Under review, the heavy hit on a Gold Coast female pitch invader. She tells 7 News why she did it. And not a car in sight as the city's major roads are taken over for the Tour de Brisbane.
Live from Brisbane, 7 News with Katrina Blowers.
Good evening. It's on. After weeks of speculation, millions of Australians will head to the polls on May 21 to decide our next government. The 6-week-long campaign is tonight already well underway, with Scott Morrison and Anthony Albanese wasting no time launching their blitz in key battlegrounds.
The pandemic Prime Minister makes his pitch for a second term.
It's a choice between a strong future and an uncertain one.
Determined his government won't become the next COVID casualty, acknowledging its failings.
Our government is not perfect. We've never claimed to be. But we are up front.
And up front that his own popularity's gone down. But trying to convince voters, it isn't about him.
This election is about you. No one else.
Leaving Kirribilli shortly before 9 this morning, boarding his jet in Sydney for the quick flight to Canberra. And then the Prime Ministerial election procession. 7 News following his convoy through the streets of Canberra, down tree-lined Dunrossall Drive, and a rowdy reception outside Government House, asking Governor-General David Hurley to dissolve the 46th Parliament and setting off on the campaign of his political life before a weary electorate.
I get it that people are tired of politics as we go into this election.
Yet opting for more politics, a longer campaign, 6 weeks, polling day May 21. As the election circus begins, Anthony Albanese with partner Jodie Hayden mixing not with political animals but real ones at Sydney's Royal Easter Show.
We were born last Monday,
so they don't get to vote yet.
Beginning his quest to become just the fourth Labor leader to win an election from opposition since World War II.
Who are you? And who are you?
Promising a different kind of leadership.
I am who I am. I'm a working class lad. I grew up not far from here, in Sydney, in public housing. I'm comfortable in a boardroom and I'm comfortable in a pub.
If Scott Morrison loses just one seat, he loses majority government with it. His first campaign stop here in the New South Wales South Coast seat of Gilmore, one of the key marginals he'll need to win if he's to cling to power. Emphasising what he says are the risks of change, trying to build a fear of the unknown.
But we're not out of the woods yet, and Australians know it. There's still a lot of uncertainty ahead.
Pushing his government's economic achievements, warning now's not the time for change.
It's a choice between a government you know and a Labor opposition that you don't.
Anthony Albanese says voters do know the Morrison government all too well.
He's running an election campaign whereby his deputy prime minister has said he's a hypocrite and a liar.
But it's not all new ideas, recycling a major theme from Mark Latham's disastrous 2004 campaign.
Australians are ready, Labor's ready, and I'm ready.
I'm ready, we are ready, and Australia is ready.
And now it's ready, set.
Hey ho, let's go.
Off to work they go.
And political editor Mark Riley joins me now from Nowra in New South Wales. Mark, tell us, what are voters in for over the next 6 weeks?
Well, the key issue in this campaign really is who wins the debate over the defining issue so far, and that is the case for change versus the risks of change. Now, both sides can see there is a general frustration in the community. Certainly people are angry about the rising cost of living and about COVID restrictions and a whole range of other issues. Anthony Albanese says the only way to address that is to change the government. Scott Morrison says when you change the government, you take on risks. That comes with putting an untested Labor Party in power. But the real tale of the tape is in the numbers. On all the major polls, the government goes into this campaign between 8 and 10 points behind. And both sides privately concede to me that this election is Labor's to win or to lose.
Thank you, Mark Riley there. Queensland will play a vital role in deciding who wins the election, with Labor expected to reverse some losses suffered in 2019. Tonight, we break down those seats in the Sunshine State that could be the difference between a Morrison or an Albanese government.
With the PM finally sending the nation to the polls, it's time for Queensland to decide.
Who would you really vote for at the moment?
The answer will help swing the election. Of the 30 Queensland electorates, the LNP hold 23 and Labor just 6, all concentrated around the southeast.
And I think everything's up for grabs.
The state's most marginal, Lilly, with just 0.6% held by Labor's Annika Wells. No surprise, it's where the would-be PM launched his Queensland campaign, where he needs to win more.
Well, certainly I think southeast Queensland is probably where the lowest hanging fruit is.
The lowest, Longman, centred around Caboolture, an LNP seat, by 3.3%. Labor's Rebecca Fanning out to steal it.
And I'm just going to make sure I'm going to be talking to as many people as possible between now and election day.
Brisbane, another LNP marginal, Trevor Evans holding it by 4.9%.
This election is about who is going to do the best for the people of Brisbane.
Other LNP seats to watch: Petrie, Ford, Bowman and Peter Dutton's Dixon. And Albo has eyes for coalition seats to the north, Leichhardt around Cairns, Herbert in Townsville, even central Queensland's Flynn. This election more than others with a presidential feel, a contest between Scott Morrison.
There is a lot of ill feeling out there.
And the alternative, Anthony Albanese.
So I'm not impressed with Albanese anyway. I mean, he said nothing. Nothing.
Anthony Albanese, even though he's not as well loved in Queens as he is in other states, I think the momentum's with him as well.
The big unknown quantity in this election is Clive Palmer. It's hard to miss that he is once again spending millions advertising his party's campaign in a bid to steer votes away from the LNP and Labor.
Look, Clive Palmer's preferences will be important here, particularly in regional Queensland. I don't think he'll do terribly well in Brisbane.
But it won't stop him trying.
Save Australia.
Only 6 more weeks of this to go. Joel Dry, 7 News.
And 7 News is your home for all the latest election coverage on the road with both camps. Everything you need to know as Australia decides. There's a surprise twist in the mandatory vaccination debate tonight. Ben Murphy, Queensland's Human Rights Commission, is challenging mandatory vaccination for teachers.
Yes, that's right, Katrina, suggesting that the Chief Health Officer acted outside of his powers. It believes Dr. Gerard's vaccine mandate for teachers and early childcare workers does not comply with the Human Rights Act and that the limits the mandate imposed on human rights are unjustifiable. The Commission also says there should have been more consideration for alternatives which are less restrictive than vaccine mandates.
I think that they've played an important role in managing the pandemic, but this is a matter that is subject of further consideration by the courts, and I'll leave my statements to that.
The submissions were part of a legal challenge which has been lodged here by suspended teachers and childcare workers.
Thank you, Ben Murphy there. Boris Johnson has walked the streets of Kyiv, with Britain offering more weapons to help Ukraine. He's the latest world leader to visit Volodymyr Zelensky as Ukraine warns of increased fighting in the country's east. The British Prime Minister's visit kept secret before his arrival.
I think that the Ukrainians have shown the courage of a lion, but you, Volodymyr, have given the roar of that lion.
The UK will send more than 100 armoured vehicles and 800 anti-tank missiles to the war zone. Following Russia's withdrawal from northern Ukraine, civilians are telling stories of mass kidnappings and assassinations by snipers. Entire towns have been reduced to rubble, with people living on the streets, knowing their country will never be the same.
Does life ever return to normal after a war is fought in your town? This is Hostomel, population 17,000. At least, that was the population. The major employer was a glass factory. Hundreds here are unaccounted for. Many are dead. The Russians attacked Hostomel from the air in the opening days of the war before a ground battle that lasted weeks. The people who are hiding underground have emerged to discover what's left of their homes and learn their lives have changed again. They're now cooking outside, using an abandoned Russian generator to charge their phones.
How long do you think you'll be living like this?
The local council has told them 4 months, Alexei says. He can't quite believe it either. A long time to live with the reminders of what's happened here all around you. People here tell us they were offered the chance to leave by the Russians, but only to go to Belarus. They think some of those missing were taken there as prisoners.
It wasn't just the fear of artillery and shelling that gripped this town, or the fact the Russians were in control, but what people couldn't see. The occupying soldiers told them if they went outside, snipers would shoot.
That's what happened to Yuri Prolivko.
Yuri Lish, mass mayor.
Yuri, our mayor. Yuri, my friend, the local priest tells me. Now buried in a makeshift grave in the churchyard. Father Peter tells me how he waved a white flag above his head while retrieving Yuri's booby-trapped body. The mayor had been out delivering aid to residents during the Russian occupation. He believes the soldiers couldn't bring themselves to kill a priest. He spray-painted messages in the streets, pleading for mercy, but the church itself didn't escape shelling or bullets. Putin is even worse than Hitler, he says, admitting people he's never seen come to church have suddenly decided to visit. So many prayers waiting to be answered. In Hostomel, Ukraine, Hugh Whitfeld, 7 News.
It's taken 263 days, but Brisbane finally has a committee to oversee the Brisbane 2032 Olympics. But there's criticism from within over why it's taken so long.
The dream of 2032 Olympic glory resting on the shoulders of a Brisbane boy.
I'm a self-professed sports nut. It's right up there as the top possible honour.
A state high and University of Queensland grad, Andrew Leveris, has had a building named after him. He's advised former US President Donald Trump.
America first, as you said.
And was CEO of a multi-billion dollar company. Now he's taking on the surmountable challenge of writing Brisbane into the Games history books as president of the organising committee board.
There's a lot of expectation, and there should be. Brisbane's coming of age story now has a very big milestone in front of it.
He heads a team of 20 comprising titans of industry and business, sporting veterans and politicians.
How long it's taken to get to this point has been criticised by the Lord Mayor. Adrian Schrinner saying he's very disappointed almost an entire year has been wasted simply putting together a committee, calling it nothing short of ridiculous.
Adding, we certainly can't afford further dilly-dallying like this on the many key decisions to come if we're going to deliver the greatest ever games. Those key decisions...
Technically the name of the organising committee, the structures and the timing of how structures will roll out, establishing the commissions and committees.
There will be setbacks. I make no mistake about it. I'm just really chaffing at the bit to get working.
Decision-making begins when the board first meets later this month. Sally Guite, 7 News.
Two people are dead and another is fighting for life after a horror crash near Nanango. Ned Balm, it was an incredibly confronting scene for those first responders.
It was, Katrina. Paramedics rushed to the Barkers Creek flat location just later this afternoon, where two people were killed after their car ran off the road and smashed into a power pole on the Diagula Highway. Now, one person was airlifted via rescue chopper here to the PA hospital in a serious but stable condition with abdominal injuries. But investigators, they want to know more about the driver's behaviour in the lead up to the crash. We understand two people from a separate car are assisting police with their inquiries.
All right, thank you, Ned Balm. A security guard's tackle on a shirtless female pitch invader at an NRL game on the Gold Coast is now under review. The woman has told 7 News she has no regrets.
It started with this.
My actual biggest goal to life has been to actually just run on the football field.
I'm doing this,
ready?
Titans fan Javon Johnson interrupting the Eels vs Titans game last night, dodging one security guard before the second didn't miss.
If you thought the Titans got hammered, the ground invader slaughtered, cut in half. What a shot.
Security guards' actions are being investigated. The Titans are working with Cbus Super Stadium and their security provider to get a full understanding of the incident.
I thought they probably should have taken it down a little bit easier than that. But anyway, you're on the field. Open slather, I suppose.
Titans chairman Dennis Watt described the tackle as heavy-handed and over the top, saying it put the intruder at real physical risk. Javon told 7 News, "I got what I deserved. He was doing his job."
If it was a man doing it, there would be no reaction.
She has been charged and will face court in 2 weeks.
She wants to run on the field. Bad luck.
On the Gold Coast, Caitlin Steadman, 7 News.
Police have launched a search for a fisherman missing in the Whitsundays. Lee Eastham left a boat ramp at Pioneer Bay yesterday afternoon with a small dog on board. An RACQ rescue helicopter has been helping police with the search for his 3-metre tinny. And in Brisbane, swiftwater rescue crews raced to the Brisbane River after reports of a boat sinking off Hamilton. Police say no one was on board the 10-metre yacht at the time. It's unknown what caused the vessel to sink. It's the race that stops the River City. Bikes replaced cars on major arterials today, but it was for a good cause, raising money to help researchers make medical discoveries.
Tour de Brisbane, bringing Lycra en masse to a city swarming with cyclists on a sunny Sunday morning. On the Story Bridge, a tale of endurance. On Mount Cutha, they grinded their way up with a calm determination.
Mount Cutha's obviously a killer after 90 kilometres.
But there was plenty of motivation, 110 kilometres of roads, all theirs. The Western Freeway, City Tunnels, South Bank. Today, Brisbane belonged to bikes.
Get away from your hometown and have a bit of fun with your mates.
Cool this morning, and it's warmed up, the sun's out, no rain, and it was absolutely tip-top out there on the road.
Almost 6,000 riders agree.
The Tour de Brisbane is about more than just cycling the streets of our great city. It's also a chance to raise money for the Common Good, a charity that helps fund crucial medical research.
Heart disease, lung disease, dementia and mental health. So we're really delighted. Every dollar raised today is going to support the scientists and researchers to help us save more lives.
The goal is to raise $250,000.
We don't just fund them year to year, we're trying to back them all the way to a conclusion. We're getting some significant breakthroughs.
Competition is over for another year, but fundraising efforts continue in the race to make medical discoveries. Ned Balm, 7 News.
Now to Tony Auden, and crowds made the most of those clearer skies across the southeast today.
Yes, Katrina, from the bikes this morning to some picnics by the water this afternoon. I'm at South Bank at the moment, where families behind me here have been enjoying some live music just a few hours ago and enjoying these beautiful, cool autumn evenings at the moment. But not to be outdone, crowds flocked to the beaches today. These shots from the Gold Coast. The water temperature still warm up at 25 degrees, but we have to be careful. A hazardous surf warning still in effect. So, well, we're staying between the flags and staying safe. Now, we do have some more sunshine on the way. Katrina, I'll be back soon with the forecast.
Thanks, Tony. See you then. It's a holiday that's out of this world. Next, the first tourists check into the International Space Station for their 7-day, $70 million holiday. Dismissed, Pakistan's Prime Minister and former Test cricketer Imran Khan ousted from power. The French go to the polls to begin picking their next president. And in flashback, Queensland's greatest mascots of all time put the bin chicken to shame.
This week on 7 News, inside the southeast's suburb explosion. They're growing fast, full of families, and caught in a cost of living trap. So what's being done? Plus, time for action on the rental crisis. Our campaign keeps gathering speed, fighting for a fair go. 7 News is Queensland's news.
There's been a tragic end to a morning swim on North Stradbroke Island with a 60-year-old man drowning. Family members alerted authorities around 7:30 this morning after the man was swept out to sea in rough conditions. He was found and pulled from the water but couldn't be revived. The war in Ukraine is dominating the first stage of France's presidential election, with voters heading to the polls right now to decide which two candidates will face off in a final round. Sarah Greenalch joins us live from Paris. Sarah, has Emmanuel Macron's handling of the crisis cemented his re-election?
Well, it certainly seemed that way a few weeks ago, Katrina, but this morning as voting gets underway, his team here is nervous. Emmanuel Macron was late to the campaign trail, having put all his energy into dealing with Putin's war in Ukraine. And initially, those diplomatic efforts did pay off. There was a surge in the polls, but as the price of food and fuel here has continued to rise, voters have realised this conflict is affecting their daily lives and their leader has been somewhat absent. Macron's main rival, Marine Le Pen, has seized on this. She is far-right, anti-immigration, but has been diluting her rhetoric and campaigning on cost of living. She's also managed to successfully deflect attention away from her close ties with Vladimir Putin, the Russian president, who publicly backed her campaign in 2017. Voting is not compulsory in this country, and the turnout is expected to be lower than usual. There are 12 candidates in this first round. It is the top two who will make it to that final one. They will go head-to-head later this month. And Katrina, the French say that this round is for voting with one's heart, the next round with one's head.
Oh, interesting times. Thank you very much, Sarah. It's history in space, but this is no 10-minute joyride. Paying customers are now on board the International Space Station, where they'll stay for the next 8 days.
Ignition. Stop. Go Falcon, go Dragon. Godspeed, Axiom 1.
Liftoff for a first-time mission. SpaceX shuttling three private paying customers to the International Space Station for the first time.
6 metres in closing.
This morning, they capsuled docking 400 kilometres above the Atlantic Ocean.
And there we are.
A real estate mogul from Ohio, a Canadian investor, and a former Israeli fighter pilot escorted by a former NASA astronaut. But first, Houston had a problem.
Expect a hold at waypoint 2 for ISS troubleshooting.
The team forced to wait 20 metres from the ISS for about an hour. Once on board...
I mean, I'm thrilled and honoured to be up here, and the responsibility is for this first civilian crew to get it right.
Each paid $73 million for the 10-day trip. They'll carry out research and demonstrations to help a private company build its own commercial space station. The aim? To one day make this ticket to the stars available to more than the millionaires. In the United States, Ashley Mullaney, 7 News.
It's been another busy day for Princess Anne in Australia, her homage to the brave men and women who fought Australia's bushfires. A memorial underway right now over a Queensland murder that shocked two nations, remembering British backpacker Carolyn Stuttle 20 years on. On the level, you won't believe what happens when a speeding train ploughs into a car. And what's driving the huge surge in demand for couples getting IVF?
Forget the bin chicken, how our most loved mascots were born. Mighty Matilda, Expo Oz and Borobee. Flashback 7 News, coming up soon.
Twenty years on from a backpacker's murder that shocked two countries, Carolyn Stuttle isn't forgotten. A memorial service is being held tonight in Bundaberg to mark the anniversary.
In the regional city, as horrified as England was, Bundaberg remembers Caroline Stuttle.
Her life was taken away too soon.
She was the British backpacker who followed her travel dream to an awful death.
It sounded like a young girl in trouble.
We couldn't see anyone on the bridge.
20 years on, the bridge is still there. The mystery, too. Why did drifter Ian Privety hurl Caroline over the railing? High on drugs, he stole her bag, then her life. The convicted murderer is now out on parole.
I mean, she wanted to be a criminal psychologist, ironically enough.
They've taken a life maybe in one fleeting moment of anger,
But that family has the rest of their life to be missing that person.
Back in England, the 2002 horror story didn't seem real. Some days it still doesn't.
That was one of my favourites with her.
Caroline was 19.
It's been longer than she's passed than she was alive.
She might have had a family, and I'd have been a grandma.
Her family's focus for the past two decades has been helping others travel the way Caroline couldn't, safely, launching an educational website, an app, and releasing a book.
We feel that it's a legacy for Caroline.
A legacy that lives on in Bundaberg.
It was just as shocking what had happened to Caroline for them as it was for us. You
know? On a day as painful as this, they're grateful for the love in a town which tragically became her last stop. Michelle Jensen, 7 News.
Queen Elizabeth's daughter, Princess Anne, has spent a second busy day down under. Her first stop was the New South Wales Rural Fire Service headquarters. There, she spent time with firefighters and victims of the 2019 bushfires.
Thank you for allowing me to join you today, but to also remember those that did have to sacrifice their lives.
Then it was on to inspect a maritime training ship. Princess Anne's royal tour will finish tomorrow. Imran Khan has been sensationally ousted as Prime Minister of Pakistan. He lost a vote of no confidence after the country's High Court rejected his move to dissolve Parliament. The former cricketing great blames a US-led conspiracy for the move against him. Pakistan's Parliament will meet tomorrow to decide a new PM. A family of five have had a lucky escape in Argentina after a train smashed into their car on a railroad crossing outside Buenos Aires. Footage shows the male driver trying to push the stalled vehicle across the track, only to be sent flying through the air. His wife and three children were in the car at the time. All five escaped with just minor injuries. IVF providers have been stunned by a surge in demand during the pandemic. Patients are now starting the process much earlier than planned.
John and Laura Summers are preparing to start their second IVF journey. John survived testicular cancer. The couple beat the odds and welcomed baby Adeline last year, sharing their experience online.
But we were super lucky, and now we have our little baby after 15 egg retrievals and
my two surgeries.
John had a couple of surgeries as well, so it was a long road for us.
The latest Medicare figures show rather than slowing over the pandemic, demand for services surged. Over 2 years to the end of 2021, IVF procedures rose 27% nationally. The biggest jump was in Victoria, up 36%. Next were Queensland and New South Wales.
We're so busy. We have increased our business by about 1,000 cycles a year.
Patients have told doctors living through COVID-19 made them reassess priorities.
I think people realise what's important in life. Actually, having a family is more important than anything else.
Pandemic shutdowns made it extremely difficult for many Australians trying to start a family. But most clinics say they've now caught up on missed appointments and they're eager to take on new patients.
I think the biggest thing is just start. If you need to, just get in the game.
Emma O'Sullivan, 7 News.
An 80-year-old couple's brush with death after their caravan bursts into flames, the full dramatic police video. Gel Blaster Warriors take aim at the Australian Championships in Brisbane, while the police minister is a financial sponsor. The Birdsville Racers back on track with an event that's making history. And standing tall, the mascots that helped put Queensland on the international map. A couple aged in their 80s have escaped the wreck of their burning caravan with just seconds to spare thanks to quick-thinking police. Video from the officer's body-worn camera shows the dramatic rescue after a crash on the southwestern highway south of Perth.
Go.
I'm so glad to see you alive.
Incredibly, just moments after they were freed, the fuel tank exploded. As the state with the most relaxed rules on gel blasters, Queensland has again played host to the sport's biggest competition. The police minister who sponsored the event says gel blasters are regulated and safe.
It's like stepping into a video game with weapons that look real but shoot small gel balls. They don't hurt much. What hurts more, players say, is the unfair stigma around this hobby.
We don't call them guns, we call them blasters.
Probably one of the fastest growing sports in Australia.
And growing among children. Seth is 11.
It's a good, fun sport. Get the fitness and everything.
New laws were introduced in Queensland last year, putting restrictions on gel blasters.
Other states have chosen to prohibit it. We chose to have a safety framework. It's a $200 million plus industry for Queensland, and that's big money and that's lots of jobs.
South Australia is the only other state where gel blasters are legal, but the rules are strict. Players need a firearms licence. So Brisbane is best placed to play host for the National Gel Blasting Championships.
We really appreciate the privilege to be able to come up and do it.
Players say this sport is about more than just having good aim. It's tactical, requiring teamwork and endurance.
That's actually how I started getting into the sport, to get my boy off of Fortnite and the Xbox, and now he loves it. We do it as a family.
We go out and we just have some fun.
Laura Dimmick, 7 News.
The outback town of Birdsville has exploded, with thousands making the trek to the Simpson Desert for a historic race meeting. It's the first time in the event's 140-year history that two race meetings are being held in the same year. COVID meant last September's races had to be bumped to this month.
Yeah, look, we haven't done it since September 2019, so we're pretty excited, and it's weird to have a Birdsville races in April.
The races continue tomorrow. As we heard earlier, Brisbane now has a board to oversee the Olympics. One of their big decisions will be to pick a mascot. Forget the bin chicken. Tonight in Flashback, the mascots that showcased us to the world. That is just ahead on 7 News. Sport time now, and Webby, some drama in the NRL.
Katrina, it wouldn't be rugby league without some. Hello, everyone. A public apology from one sorry warrior. A record crowd in Melbourne to watch the Ferrari fly to first. And Aussie favourite Cameron Smith within striking distance of a green jacket.
As Keating rose against Hawke, as Howard swept to power, Mark Riley reported it all.
People are getting ripped off, aren't they?
He knows Canberra inside out, and he will make sure you know what's going on. Mark Riley reports to you exclusively on 7 News.
Marcelo Montoya has apologised for his homophobic slur towards Kyle Felt. The Warriors winger is now in the hands of the judiciary. On the field, the Sharks continue the Tigers' miserable run, while last night at Robina, a slow start cost the Titans against Parramatta.
The world's biggest ever dummy half. Five would-be defenders swatted aside by a rampaging David Fifita.
Fifita takes a guff and he may have got there.
That was a game highlight. The lowlight, players deliberately milking penalties so they can get the ref's attention to request a captain's challenge on previous plays.
This is a shambles. Now, this is not capital.
Look, the easy one is get it right the first time when we're not doing all that stuff.
20-0 ahead, the Eels had to withstand an impressive home team fight back. AJ Brimson's deft in-goal grubbers works of art. They fell just short, but three defeats by a combined 16 points has the coach sanguine.
They're hard lessons to learn when you play games like that and lose, but you can fast track your improvement a lot.
At Shark Park, Cronulla was in cruise control against the disappointing Tigers. Sione Katoa enjoying the freedom of poor outside defence.
Katoa for a second.
Crazy and dangerous scenes after half-time. A spectator with a flare invaded the field.
Well, this is outrageous. I mean, where's the security here?
Play held up as the flare was extinguished. The fire well and truly out on the toothless Tigers too, as more pressure falls on coach Michael Maguire. Ben Dobson, 7 News.
The Roosters have been crowned the NRLW champions, taking care of the St George Illawarra Dragons in today's grand final. The Tricolours broke the game open in the second half after conceding the game's first try.
The Sydney Roosters, from nowhere, sneak into the finals and are premiers for the first time.
Sarah Togatuki won the Karen Murphy Medal for Player of the Match. Around 8,000 fans travelled to Redcliffe to watch the two Sydney teams compete. They're calling it the biggest weekend sporting event in Australian history, the return of Formula One Grand Prix. Ferrari's Charles Leclerc won from start to finish, and Daniel Ricciardo celebrated his first home race in 3 years.
More than 420,000 fans over 4 days, the Grand Prix's back.
It's nuts, mate. It's nuts. All week it's been nuts.
A quiet moment for the hometown hero before green lights.
Away we go. Decent start from Charles Leclerc.
One Ferrari flew ahead, the other went spinning out.
What a horrible start.
A long, lonely walk for Carlos Sainz. Daniel Ricciardo settled in behind teammate Lando Norris. Sebastian Vettel hit the wall.
That's highly unusual.
Then trouble for Max Verstappen.
That's some weird fluid.
The world champion's Red Bull caught fire, while Leclerc gave Ferrari a record 13th Australian Grand Prix.
Let's go, come on, yes!
A 34-point championship lead after 3 races from the man from Monaco. Ricciardo was 6th, his first points of the season.
Why is it so black here? Is that my brake dust? Am I braking too much?
Pushing for a championship, you know?
Oof. Trouble for Shane Van Gisbergen in the supercars.
And that tyre's gone! That has blown!
A happy 30th birthday for Chaz Mostert.
That's what you got to do. You got to try and put Shane under pressure.
Still third, 162 points behind and 6 wins to 3 to SVG. But a battle's brewing. Matt Shervington, 7 News.
Cameron Smith is within striking distance of becoming Australia's second Masters champion. The only player to break 70 in a brutal third round, Smith cut Scotty Scheffler's lead to just 3 shots. He'll play with the world number one as the final pair tomorrow morning.
An unseasonably shivering 10 degrees with bitter, howling wind chill. Ask Billy Horschel. Or Adam Scott and Tiger Woods how tough it was today. Scott shot 80, his worst round there in 18 years.
That is holding up there by a prayer.
In clear pain, Tiger gamely battled on for a 78, his worst ever round at Augusta.
I thought it was tough. I mean, some of the other guys may not say that.
You'd sell everyone par at the start of on the first tee.
That tells the brilliance of Smith to beat par by 4.
Oh, again, it's going to be good. Look at this.
Mullet flapping in the wind, nothing less than masterful from the 28-year-old Queenslander.
Cam Smith for birdie.
Even with freezing hands.
I had hand warmers all day, but I don't think they help.
Like all his heroes, Smith's now the one we'll wake and watch, trying to emulate that magical morning 9 years ago when Scott won Australia's only green jacket.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I've been watching this tournament since I can remember, so hopefully everyone gets up early and I can make some birdies.
Scotty Scheffler led by 6 into the back 9, almost too calm.
And that's the shot of a champion.
Not yet. At 18, the 25-year-old world number one hit a drive that may have cost all sleep, and his lead was down to 3. Matt Carmichael, 7 News.
A dominant third quarter has put the Suns on track for their second win of the season. Queensland icon Michael Voss was back home for the first time since returning as a senior coach. He saw his trump Paddy Cripps off early with a hamstring. The Suns and Mabior Chole putting a gap on their opponent after half time.
Chole might get his third. He's gone bang, bang to start this third.
The Suns comfortably leading the unbeaten Blues during the final quarter. Georgia Miller has held off Courtney Hancock to sprint her way to a third Australian Iron Woman title. Ali Day had to paddle his way back into the field from 5th before a breakout final ski leg shot Day to the top.
I had to really work for it today, so that's just the best, hey.
7,500 competitors took part in this year's Surf Life Saving Championships on the Gold Coast. Katrina, that's our weekend sport.
Thanks, Webby. Well, Queensland already has 9 official emblems, but the state government has decided we need a 10th. It's now put forward a dozen possibilities to become Queensland's fossil emblem. Among the choices, dinosaurs, plants, even an ancient platypus with teeth. And if you'd like to have your vote, you can head to our Facebook page. Queensland has hosted some big events with some big mascots to match. Tonight, as planning begins for the 2032 Olympics, we remember Matilda, Expo Oz and Borobie. That is flashback after the break.
And how's the weather looking as we move towards the Easter long weekend? I'll have the forecast up next from here at South Bank.
This week on 7 News, inside the southeast's suburb explosion. They're growing fast, full of families, and caught in a cost of living trap. So what's being done? Plus, time for action on the rental crisis. Our campaign keeps gathering speed, fighting for a fair go. 7 News is Queensland's news.
It's been a week since the tourism minister thrust the ibis into the spotlight as a potential Olympic mascot. So that got us thinking, what makes a truly great mascot? Queensland has had a few, as Max Futcher reports. Must go, must go.
Moscow set the mascot bar high in 1980. Queensland was determined to do better.
This is Brisbane's answer to Mishka, a real, live, lovable 18-month-old kangaroo, named, of course, Matilda. For the camera-shy young grey, it proved a petrifying experience.
A mascot must sell tickets. Matilda was a jet-setting marsupial marketeer.
This wasn't your average Skippy-type kangaroo. It was Matilda, the official mascot for the 1982 Commonwealth Games, and as such was afforded VIP treatment on Ansett's inaugural direct flight to Canberra this afternoon.
And then the opening ceremony arrived.
And here she is, she's coming into the stadium. The First Lady, Matilda. And have a look at this.
Her wink won the world over, and her 20 joeys hopped onto a global stage. Lee Scott was 8 years old when she bounced into history.
This is the main part of the suit that we wore. This is the tail that kept flopping around and hitting us in the head. And these are the ears that we put ahead so we look like kangaroos.
Safe to say, Matilda was a mighty success. Bring on Expo 88. Expo Oz, the platypus, turned skeptics into season pass holders.
3, 2, 1.
Mascots must also sell millions of dollars worth of merchandise.
But the star is obviously Expo Oz, the portly platypus. This cuddly version, around $20. He even walks on water. You'll be able to drink out of Oz, write with him, clean your teeth with him, stick, sew or post him.
Expo Oz was a crowd favourite people found irresistible. Fast forward to the 21st century.
Meet your Gold Coast 2018 Commonwealth Games mascot, Borrowby. Isn't he a little beauty?
Australia's first surfing koala was an instant hit.
And he's so cute, you want to give him a cuddle.
That is another key mascot quality.
The koala was really cute. I wanted to cuddle him.
Probably why the Sydney mascots were a little too prickly.
Sid, Millie and Ollie.
And less memorable. And why 2032 organisers should look to the past for inspiration for the Olympic mascot of the future.
Yeah, we can't go with the ibis. And of course, without Expo, there would be no South Bank, and that is where Tony is tonight.
Yes, Katrina, and what a great spot to wind down the weekend here. We've enjoyed plenty of sunshine today. A warm day, but these cooler autumn evenings that have just set in over the last couple of weeks. Onto the maps, and of course, lots of blue sky and sunshine across the region today. Great conditions for the kids to get out and about, and with the family, of course. 19 to a top of 28 degrees here in Brisbane. Onto the satellite. Well, it's all been pretty quiet over land in Queensland today. A trough is hovering just out into the Coral Sea and bringing rain and storms over water, but they have stayed off the coast. Elsewhere, ex-cyclone Feely continues to push against a high to the south, the resulting winds pushing large easterly swells onto our coast. Into tomorrow, we expect more blue sky in the far south of Queensland, a few more showers near the trough around the central coast. Now, around the capitals tomorrow, morning shower in Melbourne, afternoon shower in Canberra, and late showers in Sydney. Back to northern Queensland, storms around Weipa and the peninsula, trade winds, a couple of those showers around Cairns, Mackay, maybe just in Townsville, but not as likely there as those more exposed coasts. In the south, just a few patches of cloud here and there and staying dry for the major centres here, tops of 29 from Gympie up towards Bundaberg. For the southeast, mostly sunny skies ahead for your Monday. No excuse for the kids not to get outside again at some stage for some school holiday activities. But be careful on the beaches. A hazardous surf warning remains current, so please stay between the flags. Warming up a little bit after a slightly cooler night. As I mentioned, tops of 30 in Kenmore and Oxley, 16 to 29 at Mount Gravatt.
Out on the water, south-southwesterlies early and late. They'll turn east-southeast up to 15 knots through much of the daytime. Offshore, easterly swells up to 2.5 metres. So here in Brisbane, mostly sunny skies ahead. 18 tonight, a beautiful warm top of 29 degrees. And looking ahead, even hotter on Tuesday, 30. Then the next cooler wind change arrives on Wednesday, back to 26 degrees with a couple of showers hanging around. In Ipswich, 27 with a shower or two on Wednesday. Then that chance of rain starts to ease back again into Thursday and Friday. On the Gold Coast, waves easing back a little from Tuesday, but still some mid-sized swell to keep surfers happy later this week. And Sunshine Coasters, Wednesday brings that highest chance of rain, then clearing up and warming up towards next weekend. So Katrina, a little bit of up and down in the weather through the course of the next week, but it looks like conditions are improving as we move towards that Easter long weekend.
Thank you, Tony. Well, that is all from us this Sunday. Thank you for your company. Coverage of day one of the election campaign tomorrow in Sunrise. But for now, from all the team, have a great night.